Wash your hands.
Okay. Welcome to the Situate ZBA. As you can see, there's a little bit of change on the board. I am the newly elected chair, elected by these guys, nobody else. But my name is Sarah Treesize. I have been a board member 9 years, so. I'm going to reintroduce, because we do have a new board member, but for clarity of the record, I'll reintroduce everybody. To my right here is Mr. Tibbetts, to my left, Edward Tibbetts, Edward C. Tibbetts, and to my left is John Hallen. Frank Lynch, Francis M. Lynch is the first alternative, and we have a new member, Anthony Boucher.
Boucher. Very new member.
I will say for the record that neither Mr. Lynch nor Mr. Boucher were here for the prior meeting. However, pursuant to the statute, to which I cannot cite, they have read a copy of the transcript and certified that they have indeed read it and have made it a part of the record. With that, I'll let you, first of all, I'll take care of a little business. We're going to go to 10 tonight. I think that's certainly long enough for the court reporter.
Exactly.
And let me introduce also Nicole. Nicole is the assistant building inspector and zoning enforcement officer, but tonight she is doing her third to 12th job as the zoning secretary. So, particularly for consideration of those two women who are taking the notes, 10 o'clock is certainly long enough. We talked amongst ourselves and anticipate that it's going to take a third meeting. Do you agree?
Do I agree?
Yes.
I would anticipate that.
Okay. Nicole checked with the library and August 29th is available, and that works for each of the board members. Does that work for you?
It should. No coverage. I live off my cell phones. I don't know my calendar, but my guess is August 29th.
You meant no coverage, yes, and
no coverage of myself.
Oh.
You're welcome to sit down.
August 29th is not good for you. I don't know quite what to say about that because it's kind of the main players are available. I don't know what else we could do in terms of after that we're into September, and that's more than a month away. Is that a problem?
Well, we're going to stop bumping up against the deadline with respect to a decision, notwithstanding state law, which we understand this will be an ongoing proceeding for a period of time. So we will sign whatever extensions necessary for the variance under state law. But under federal law, there's an outside window of 150 days, which I think pegs us middle of September. That means decision written by.
Okay.
Yeah, we should pin that down that date, don't you?
Yeah.
And you'll be getting a correspondence from me about 45 days out, so probably the next 2 weeks, laying out the timeline of it's called the shot clock. Okay. I'll lay out the timeline of the board so that we're on the record. We fully disclose here's our calculation of the shot clock and when the decision should be ready. So that will be forthcoming in writing.
But do you think it's mid-September?
I do.
Well, that's going to really cut us too close. Comments from the board here, what you want to do, if you can accommodate. Mr. Attorney Cirque is the gentleman who just stood up, and you're representing some of the abutters, correct?
Correct.
In terms of being able to accommodate that, and given the deadline is kind of bad.
Well, it's availability of a meeting place. It's trying to be consistent with Thursdays, which is what we've always done.
It's difficult to find a meeting place that will accommodate this
right.
Type of crowd. I can't do it at town hall.
Yeah, and then it's
meeting
not
meeting space is just so tight around town.
Yeah.
August 29th, but kind of late. I don't know if there's something we can do before then, in the middle of August, or another night, or whenever.
I can run upstairs if you want us. We'll do it maybe Wednesday earlier in August, I can.
Yeah.
The 8th of the go back. 8th of
the.
that's awfully close to get anything else done in August. Nicole's going to run upstairs and see what else we can do. Yeah, and that, I think if we put it into September, we're going to be in trouble. We have another zoning is on 15.
Last question on the law here. Last question at this time.
Sure.
Richard Dillon, 364.
I'm sorry, can't hear you.
Richard Dillon, 364, Tillamook. What are the consequences if that date is not?
I assume it's the same as anything. It's constructive approval.
No, actually, to be fair, it's not constructive approval or deemed approved. It's under the federal law, that is what's deemed to be reasonable under the Telecommunications Act of 1996. So the board has to act within a reasonable period of time. So it gives a presumption that the timeline has not been reasonable, and it would give AT&T the ability to then seek relief, if that be the case. It's not deemed though.
Did you understand that? Not exactly, right? All right, the concern would be, the first concern would be what they call constructive approval. That means if we don't act, they get it anyway. Mr. Price says that's not so, but it's certainly a situation that we, as a board, do not intend to be contemplating at the last minute. We're not going to let it happen. The meetings are going to have to be scheduled so that we can get it all done within the time frame. Period.
We will be reasonable, but we go the timeline, and if we can keep to it, we will. If we have to have further discussion because of circumstances beyond all of our control, then we'll deal with that when we get there.
Get some dates.
Tuesday.
Right. We got Monday, August 5th, probably too soon. Tuesday, August 13th. Tuesday, August 20th. Wednesday, August 21st.
20th and 21st. So the 20th or the 13th?
I say 20th is not good, or is good. But not good for me either.
August 13th? Is that gives us how much time?
It's a lot better than the 29th.
That's like 3 weeks away. Is that good?
Too bad.
Okay. All right, so what? So
Tuesday.
That'll be Tuesday, August 13th for the next meeting.
I have a quick meeting, but I'll fix it.
Okay.
That's here?
That'll be here again.
7:00.
Okay, it's 2 weeks.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And as I said, I'll calculate under the state law so that we don't run into a constructive grant situation. I will prepare an agreement to sign to extend the decision date like we did in the last time. I'll provide that.
Okay, very good. And the final thing I'll say is remind people we are being taped anyway. Is it simultaneously televised?
No, it's not live. It'll probably be airing by tomorrow, and it will be up on YouTube.
There you go. You're all YouTube stars. So, with that, I'll turn the meeting over to you, and you can continue.
Great. A couple of things, housekeeping. I have, we submitted some electronic documents at the beginning of the week, a noise study, some additional photo simulation based on a balloon test that was requested by Mass Historic. And I don't know if you, I assume you received those, but I want to be sure that you received them. I do have printouts here. If you didn't, I'll be happy to provide printed copies if that helps, and I have extras for folks in the audience that haven't received them yet. Does anyone need?
I'll welcome them to come.
Noise?
I got the noise study. Must have seen the other thing on there.
You need the photo sets?
Yes?
A noise study?
Yeah.
We also received a letter from Verizon in support of the application, that they have an interest in co-locating. I'll deliver that. I think that's it for our handouts. I thought what we might do is bring George Valentine up. I'm a little out of order because of the folks that are missing, but George is the real estate consultant. He could probably address the open questions that were there and then answer questions from folks in the audience. That would be efficient use of our time, I guess. So I'll introduce George Valentine.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I think you all know me. I've presented before you. The last hearing, we had a question from an abutter regarding marketing time of one of the sales that I utilized in apparent sales analysis. It was 62 Highland Crossing. And I looked on MLS to get a property history, and the marketing time indicated from MLS was 20 days for that sale. I understand that one of the abutters said that it had been on the market quite a long time, and I'm not sure, quite frankly, if it had been on and off prior to that. But this that was the information from MLS. I have a copy of the MLS sheet for you saying that. And subsequently, that sale, that property actually resold in December of 2012 for $570,000, which is a $15,000 decrease. The marketing time at that time is 19 days. So clearly the marketing time is not an issue. That was, I think, the only question that was directed to me.
I think we also plan to make George available for any questions. We kind of got just former chairman was getting late in the night, so if there are other questions of George on the board or your butters, we're happy to have him respond.
Well, let's start with anybody. Do you have any questions? Okay. I think it makes sense, obviously, to open up to the floor. And so if Mr. Valentine, you know, needs to leave or wants to leave, we can do that. Does anybody from the audience have any questions for Mr. Valentine?
I have some relevance.
Okay. I'm sorry. First of all, just to kind of keep it clear, questions, if people who have a question would stand, the chair will recognize them. You need to state your name and address for the record, and then address the question to the board, or to the chair, not to any of the experts, and that's the way it'll go. It's not a dialogue with an expert, just so it's clear. Yes, this is real estate. Okay. Yes.
Mary Stackpole, President of the Chair. Didn't know on the Sun Road until the last
community. Okay. Do you want to explain the relevance of it?
During the last hearing, one of the abutters was familiar with one of the properties that I used in my analysis. It was a house that was located about 300 feet from existing power in Scituate. It sold. And then I used a comparison of that sale, which is very close to a tower, to other very similar homes in Scituate that are not don't have the any perceived effect of the tower, to see if there was any difference. And the abutter that had a question said, well, if it doesn't have a impact on the value, it doesn't have an impact on the marketing time. So I went back to MLS and found out that this house sold in 20 days, so therefore it does not appear to have any impact on marketing time or value.
Any other questions?
Nancy Pay, 45 Mississippi Shore. It's just ironical that this house that you have here is now for sale and has been for a while, and the real estate agents have been saying that now that they know the tower is active and potentially going in, that they have a very, very difficult time when anybody watches the house that anybody wants to stay. So it's a real problem that has just cropped up now that the real estate agent knows and the listing agents know they're ethically obligated to let anybody come through when the tower's going up.
Okay, could you identify for the record the address that you're talking about?
It's right next to Smalls. It's right around 361.
Is this the same picture? Okay, yes. Yeah, that's 361 Tilden Road.
No, 361 is the Smalls house where the tower is potentially going.
The Smalls house is on for sale?
No, it's the one on the side.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, so it's next to the Smalls house, and the Smalls house is the site for the location of the tower. Okay. Any other questions? Please.
Stephen Tucker, 397 Tilden Road. If I recall correctly, Mr. Valentine's testimony is that there wouldn't be any appreciable change in market value. So I just want to make sure that I understand this. Would it be his testimony then that the acre and three-quarter building lot that we own immediately abuts on 361 Tilden Road and has frontage on Tilden Road? That building lot would not drop in value at all.
That's
even though it would be 80 feet from the tower.
That's my testimony.
Am I allowed to make a comment?
Is line?
Keep it clean.
Yeah.
It
needs to be respectful. One of the most important things is I want the applicants to respect the abutters and the abutters to respect the applicant, and we'll go forward with that.
But, you know, we put a lot of time and effort into getting those binders together, and there's a lot of testimony in there as well, expert testimony. And it comes from real estate agents, but it also comes from academics, and some of it comes from real estate appraisers. And as I understand it, by reading that material, that they say there's anywhere from 2% to a 20+% decrease in proximate property, so is that it needs to be applied. And there's other forms of testimony, so I'm saying. And it's been a long time since I've had much to do with statistics, but I know that in statistics classes, I tell you, causality is very difficult to prove. Things happen because of things, and they happen despite of things. And with that in mind, it seems to me that common sense also needs to be part of this factor. It just seems to me to defy common sense to say anybody would be interested in building a house on an acre and three-quarters piece of property that's within 8 feet of the cell tower. That defies common sense. And common sense was enough to launch a revolution that created the country. Thomas Paine wrote a series of essays. Common sense, you know? I think you have to do some of that in trying to assess the situation.
Any other comments, sir?
John Marie, 331 Tilden.
Could you just stand?
Yeah.
Makes it easier for everybody to hear.
My question is, in 2010, Mr. Warren asked the appraiser to take property from the South Shore. There are two properties taken from Martha's Vineyard, one from Citroën. Why was Martha's Vineyard chosen instead of South Shore property there at Martha?
Because we have to find areas that actually have sales activity. You know, you can't just go to a tower and say, well, let's look at this tower, it's where we want to be. If there's not before and after sales or any relevant sales data, you know, we can't draw any conclusion from it. So we take
it all so short.
This again, remember, yeah. this is not a debate.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, I look long part.
Sure.
Richard Dillon, 364 Tilden.
just a thought, hypothetical, but if 100 homes lost $25,000 in value in this general area, that would be a loss to the town of $362,000 a year in tax base if everyone is able to get an abatement.
Any other comments for, or questions rather, for Mr. Valentine? Yes, ma'am.
Yes, hi, I'm on 352 Tilden Road. I wondered if the real estate assessor, does he know how many times that house on Highland Crossing has sold in the last few years?
Sold twice since, well, sold in 2009 and 2012, and there was one other sale I saw in 1999.
And he's sold four times actually in the last 10 years as a house.
But still sold with.
But it,
okay, again, no debate. No debate. Can't be a debate. Any other questions? Okay. Mr. Valentine, thank you.
Thank you. Issue dismissed. You get the lead. There were some questions last time about the balloon test and lenses and distance, which I know nothing about. So I asked Ben Karen, who does probably the best job on balloon tests and photo simulations that I've dealt with, not only to prepare a written report as to what he did and the pictures he took and that sort of thing, but also, since no one can answer the questions, I asked Ben to attend tonight, so I'm going to ask Ben, since he got here on time, to step up, and he can give you a brief overview of what he does, how he did it. We floated a balloon recently. To get some shots that the Mass Historic Commission had asked us for. So he'll give you a brief overview. You, the board, can ask him questions if you have any concerns about what was raised last time. I know there was a discussion about the type of lens and how all of this happens for the abutters, so he's here to respond to those questions. With that, Ben Karen.
Hi, Ben Karen. I do pretty much exclusively balloon test photographic renderings for wireless and wind industry. I've actually done three balloon tests at this site now. Once was on August 26, 2010, once on May 5th of 2013, and again a couple weeks ago, July 15th, to meet the various requirements. What I do is I actually inflate very large chloroplane weather balloons, 7 foot in diameter at the top one, and then another contrasting color below that, which you'll see in the images we gave you. Makes it easy to find it from various distances and makes it easier when you're looking through foliage to have the contrasting colors. We tied them on a measured tethered line, 150 feet long, pre-tensioned. We make it as perfect as we can get it, fly it where the tower's going to go. We pick calm days, we fight for calm days, and I have someone on site throughout the test that doesn't leave those balloons. They're in contact with me with a walkie-talkie so that when I'm in position to take a photograph, I ask them on the walkie-talkie to tell me when they're perfect. I'll stand on the side of the road 20 minutes after, as long as I need to, for them to say, shoot, 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 stop, stop, stop. We only take pictures when the balloons are vertical or very near vertical so that there's no reduction in the apparent height of the tower. So each time I had an associate on site, we take our photographs when I'm in position. I use mapping grade, survey grade GPS to locate my camera position as well as the tower position. Then I go back to the office and I take that image that I took and the GPS survey data, and I can create a 3D model of the proposed structure. Build it right up exactly the way AT&T tells me it's going to be built, whether it's a monopole, tower, dive tower, doesn't matter, whatever it is. This time it was a monotree. I build it up in 3D and put it into software, the exact known distances, the known resolution from my $4,000 camera, and then I can render it. And all that does is it takes the 3D model, it renders it very slowly, mapping the materials to it, the branches, the leaves, whatever we end up using, the galvanizing, colors, whatever. And then it spits out an image. Then I can physically overlay that image and put the tree branches back over the tower, the intervening vegetation, and produce accurate photographic rendering showing what is going to be built and what it will look like from that photo location if it were approved. I basically went through the exact same procedures all three times. I produced simulations from the requested locations. And I did make an effort to, even though I was given addresses the last time specifically, I made an effort to, if you look on the sims, you can actually see that, to find the clearest, most open area I could find to get the most obvious shot possible. I did not try to hide it in any way. I actually tried very hard to find the opening so that it couldn't be challenged. The last set of simulations was a Mass Historic Commission requirement, which is why those specific addresses were chosen. I did not choose them. The first time when I did these sims, and the second time actually, I just went out and used predictive mapping to see where I thought it would be visible before I even went. And with that predictive mapping, I was able to drive around and find areas that I knew it would be visible, and that's how I selected my photo locations at first. Ironically, I ended up doing the Mass Historic ones anyway the first time.
So, Bendis, you have both combinations of photos. The only reason I submitted the second set was because there were additional. I'm sure the balloon was noted. And since we provided the Mass Historical, it gave another perspective, so we provided the board and familiar with some of that. With that, if there are questions to the board of Ben or some folks in the audience who had some questions about how this balloon thing happens, we're happy to answer.
Okay. I'll start with you, Frank, again, here on the far end.
I can't think of anything right now.
Ben?
No, I think the main concern was that there was a member of the audience last time we were here that had some familiarity with lenses, and so I'll cede any of my time so that can be answered.
Okay. John?
It sounds like, correct me if I'm wrong, but the looking at the original map, A through E is where the photos were taken from.
Well, the Mass Historical photos, correct. This map was for the last photo test.
Okay.
Not to steal thunder from more complex photo questions, but in terms of these pictures and how the camera was set up, is the object of how the camera and lenses to most accurately depict if I or someone else was standing there looking towards the tower?
Yes.
Is it supposed to be a human eye representation?
That's a good thing. I brought with me five examples, and I just pulled the first five from various resources, because it's always a debated question what lens, what focal length lens most closely represents the human eye. I have five different references here, and the first one came from Canon's website themselves, Canon USA, that states in a 35 millimeter format, a focal length of 50 millimeters is closest to what the human eye sees. The focal length is used as a reference point for lens categories, and that's considered a normal lens.
Right, and not
that's just one of many resources. I know, I just wanted to finish the thought, but 50 millimeter is typically what I use when I'm this close to the subject, within 1,000 feet. Once I get beyond 1,000 feet, I actually start to use telephoto lenses, which in effect is working against AT&T. I should be sticking with a 50 millimeter because that's the perspective the human eye would see. That being said, when you start getting pretty far away from the target, it just becomes a few pixels when I render this thing. So in my first and second renditions of the simulation sets, once I got beyond 1,000 feet, I actually used a telephoto lens, making it worse than what the human eye would see. And I did that for worst case scenario, for your benefit, for the viewer's benefit. But in all of these, the last set, all of the photo locations that actually have a limit were below 1,000 feet, so I stuck with the 50 millimeter accepted normal human.
So that's the objective. That's what
the objective is, to try to make it the same depth of field, the same perception. When you get far away and you start to really use a telephoto, things start to look flat. So that's why the 50 millimeter lens becomes important. But when you get too far away, if you don't start to use a telephoto lens, then all of the acuity of the object is actually lost. So within 1,000 feet, this is as representative as you can get.
And by telephoto, that you use the 65 millimeter lens?
I started to use 65, yeah. When I do tests and I get really far away from the subject, 2 miles, 3 miles sometimes, then I'm up in the 85, 105 millimeters, which at that point, you're using binoculars to find the things anyway. And the average person isn't going to notice it from 3 miles away walking down the street. But all of the sims that I ended up doing, because this is a relatively flat area, you really couldn't get 1.5 mile up and still see this thing anymore. The worst view I think I can remember is from Egypt Beach. I just remember that, and that was pretty far away, but I ended up using a bit of a telephoto there, otherwise the acuity was lost.
Okay. Any questions for the audience?
The second test I did on May 5th actually was pretty much leaf-off conditions. Those are in this condition. There's really no leaves at that point. I mean, it was May and we were dying on the door when the bus started to happen, but it was pretty much leaf-off for that second half.
Tracy Shepherd, 34 Cairo Circle. I just respectfully disagree with that perspective. From my property on Cairo Circle, I see the wind test out the back of my house. And I was pleasantly surprised. I was supposed to say that the blue is actually below the tree line on my property, and it's just clearly set up the tree line. But, excuse me.
The most recent test?
The May. It's May of this year.
And we certainly have some, I think in your package you have some photos from the balloon test, so that's helpful. Any other questions for Mr. Caron? Okay, thank you. That was helpful.
Do you want Ben to stick around, or are we all set?
And I think we're all set. I mean, I don't see any reason.
Thanks for having us.
That's right.
I think your consultant actually walked in when Ben was giving his presentation.
He's waving. Hello, Ivan. Okay.
What our RF engineer is not in this delay.
I know our requirement
is not here, but I would say let's proceed, because if there are any issues, I can take down some notes. I can brief Mr. Goulet. I can use the transcript if we have to for the next hearing. So with that, I have no objection to your consultant coming on board and beginning. If there are any other questions about anything else so far, I'm happy to respond, but I think this was his show tonight, so.
Okay. Yes.
Did he say, we just ask another question about anything else before this gets started?
Yes. Okay, I don't care. Our esteemed Mr. Vignetti, who is a selectman, you still have to stand and identify yourself.
Chief Justice Kushnowski. Just a quick question. I haven't been here at the prior meeting. Is AT&T considering any other method of this right now? There's gas systems and a bunch of things that are we just completely focused on the tower, and that's all you're pursuing?
Okay. Are you having to leave? Two things.
Read the transcript.
A DAS is, a DAS system is going to have great conversation. And I think the town's consultant is going to speak to that. Do you need to leave?
I believe in a little while, but.
Okay. If we haven't answered, if we haven't answered, and you have to leave.
I'll catch up with you. I just didn't know if that was on the test.
Okay. It is going to be tough. Sorry about that.
So everything's still under consideration?
It's nothing's happened yet.
All right.
As they say.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Once you open this door in this town, Pandora's box, that any AT&amp;T Verizon came into any homeowner, and is the board prepared for this to happen in town? So it's a precedent-setting variance, it's not, we can talk about cell tower, we can talk about gas, but the bigger picture is it coming in on people's private property.
I guess I'll just say, I think the board is extremely sensitive to the issues about the abutters. You remember, we live here too, and we want what is best for the town, and so please understand that we have not dismissed anything within our consideration. And with that, we're going to turn the meeting over. And I am really embarrassed to say, I don't know how to pronounce your last name.
Most people don't. It's Ivan Pagasik.
Ivan Pagasik.
Yes.
Mr. Pagasik, will you just start by identifying yourself for the record, and then just giving us a little background of, of your experience, expertise, and education?
Sure. For the record, my name is Ivan Pagasik with IDK Communications. I have been doing peer reviews since 1996, I believe it was. Been in the wireless field since 1985. I have two engineering degrees, BSET and BSEE. I'm well-versed in RF propagation and its characteristics. I don't do work for cell companies, and I don't do work for tower companies, companies that are build towers to lease to wireless carriers. My work has been primarily with states, counties, local towns, things of that nature.
Do you work outside the Massachusetts area too?
I do. I actually do. This is not my primary core business. I do a lot of work in public safety, in transportation utilities for design communication systems, various frequency ranges. Worked in a multitude of different aspects of communications, basically fiber optic, microwave, land mobile radio. I've designed neutral host systems for cellular and PCS companies at airports, for instance, where we have one system that's shared by multiple companies. Similar to a DAS type of system, except it's neutral in that one company doesn't. One cell company doesn't own it, it's owned by an independent party.
Okay. I'm going to take it away.
Okay, so I was tasked by the board and the town here to review technical information from the applicant, review the previous consultant, Mark Hutchins, who worked with the town, review his information and what he supplied the board, and to look at and comment on DAS technology, and also look at alternatives. With the first thing, looking at AT&T's technical information, I went to Mr. Hutchins' report, look at what basically he stated, how he performed his engineering, and what his conclusions were in his summaries, and agreed with his method of his analysis on the applicant's engineering. And what he provided in his report. The one thing I did note is I didn't see alternative coverage analysis. I saw an analysis of existing AT&T coverage and then the proposed site and what that would do to existing coverage. There was a lot of information, and again, stop me if I'm reiterating as I go on here. I've only been on board here for a month, so I'm
getting caught up to speed, but there was a lot of information from AT&T about alternate sites, sites that were analyzed. From my perspective, I wanted to make sure I had a clear understanding of what was doing what. So I basically started from ground zero and looked at existing coverage and looked at all these alternatives, looked at the proposed site, looked at some possible scenarios, combinations, et cetera, and I'm gonna go through that. What I handed out to you was a bunch of figures, which are coverage analysis of different scenarios, and I'll go through those. In my report, I speak about, and you've probably heard a lot of this, you've probably heard terminology and whatnot, so I'm not going to get in depth on this, but I touch upon what goes into a coverage analysis, what are the pieces that are needed, and how you calculate coverage from cellular or PCS communication sites. I then touch upon some site configuration options, and you've probably already gone through what options are out there, what are the types of structures, and stealth structures, non-stealth structures, how sites are powered, and how sites are powered in the event of loss of electrical power, and how they have backup facilities. I touched upon, again, the review of Mr. Hutchins' report, and of note that I didn't see the alternative analysis, so I jumped into a coverage analysis that looked at their existing and alternative sites and some scenarios. So, figure one in maps I sent.
Can I just ask, do you have large maps of these?
I do not have large maps.
Okay. Despite that, could you perhaps put it up so as much as possible? Turn your map to, because we all have maps here, but that allow the audience to see it.
Okay.
And even though it's not large, it'll give you as much coverage as you can.
Okay, there you go. That's fine. I don't know if that's good.
Could you maybe just attach it at the top?
There we go.
Are there any extra
copies of you have? I do have extra copies. Somebody want to be on your boards?
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, pass them out at whatever you have is, and share as much as you can.
Figure one is existing.
Can I just stop?
Sure.
Ma'am, would you mind maybe kind of heading over there? Because you're isolated by yourself, and there's a whole group over there who probably like to share it with you. Just so as many people can look upon it as possible. And feel free if you need to, as long as you're not blocking somebody else's view, to move around and get a little bit better view.
Okay, so figure one takes into account, and I should note that AT&T operates in two frequency bands. I would imagine you've had the same traffic I did.
Welcome to Situate.
AT&T operates in two frequency bands, the 800 megahertz cellular, 1900 megahertz PCS. For the purposes of this analysis right now, I'm focusing on 800 megahertz. 800 megahertz will give you larger propagation than 1900 megahertz. With all things being equal, there's more losses at 1900 megahertz than 800 megahertz. So all these maps are based on 800 megahertz. The first figure is a map that shows their existing coverage. And you can see that the green area is in building,
The orange areas are the added in-vehicle coverage afforded, and the white area is no coverage, or less than allowable coverage. From figure one, you can see that existing coverage along the coastal region of Situate, we have gaps in coverage, that propagating their existing sites. Now I looked at a bunch of alternatives. First being site on the Anvinal Road, and that would utilize a height of 147 feet. And you can see that that provides some decent in-building coverage, the green coverage, north of the site, northeast of the site. If you go southeast of the site, it doesn't fill in that coastal area. Okay. Next I looked at, and a lot of this again might be rehashed, just bear with me because I need to do this for my application. Next was the Baptist Church, using height as figure three, 50 feet. You see that does not do a lot to fill in the gaps along the coast. Minimal extra coverage from the existing configuration. Next, figure four, looked at a site at Beaver Dam Road using an antenna height of 177 feet. This provides very good coverage to that southeast portion along the coast. Lots of good in-building coverage. Has in-vehicle coverage north, but lacks some in-building coverage in that section northeast of the site. Next, figure five, looked at a site at Egypt Beach, utilizing antenna height of 177 feet. This site provides pretty good coverage at that height, but not in-building coverage throughout that coastal area. You can see it provides a good vehicle, but even there are spots in between the existing sites and location Egypt Beach where you have in-vehicle but not in-building. Next was site at Lawson Tower, 140 feet. This provides some in-vehicle coverage along the coast, but not in-building coverage in that section of Situate. Figure seven, property, Edward McLaughlin property, 147 feet. Similar, probably Egypt Beach, 177, providing coverage along the coast, but not in-building coverage in that northern and southern, southeast section. It's in-vehicle, not in-building. Next, the site at Nile Terrace at 177 feet. And you see the northern section along the coast just as in vehicle, not in building. Some smaller gaps in the east and southeast of the site that are only in vehicle and not in building. Next, the site Old Colony at 177. This is probably a little bit worse than Beaver Dam, providing good coverage in the southern part of the coast, but not the northern part of the coast, and actually less in-vehicle coverage than Beaver Dam. Figure 10, the Wampatuck School, 147 feet. Provides very good coverage, very good in-building coverage, and in-vehicle coverage to the north. The in-building coverage drops off to the north. Next, looked at the Situate Fire Department. That's the Situate Fire Department on First Parish Road. That has an existing tower, my understanding, of 110 feet. So we looked at utilizing that same height and what kind of coverage we could get. And as you can see, it does not do much for the gaps along the coast. It provides some in-building coverage near the site, but there's a lot of white area along the coast. I stayed with that site just to see what would happen if I went up to 170 feet. In other words, replace that tower and just go higher, just to see. Somehow we're filling that gap. It fills in some of it, but there's still a significant portion north that's not filled in. Then we looked at the proposed site on Tilden Road at 147 feet. And what we see is, you see the in-building coverage along the coast going in that gap area. Couple small pockets of just in vehicle, but there's a significant amount of in-building coverage along the coast at 147 feet. Next, I want to see what would happen if we drop the antenna height at the proposed site and get down to 107 feet. And you can see that the in-building area coverage drops a little bit. We still have the vehicle coverage, but there's some pockets that start to present themselves where we have less in-building coverage. We're on that threshold of in-building versus in-vehicle, so the signal strength isn't as strong. It still provides in-vehicle, but in-building coverage suffers. So, that's propagating one location and adding it to their existing coverage. Then I looked at, well, what if we took a combination of a couple sites? Keep their existing sites and take a couple of these. Now, there's probably a ton of scenarios, all right, that I could look at with respect to a couple sites. So I tried to pick, and there's been, you know, I saw some documentation that's been mentioned about the Egypt Beach area, possibly utilizing the stealth structure there, lower to the ground. So I looked at, let's say we go with a 100-foot structure at Egypt Beach, and we utilize the Situate Fire Department. You already have a tower there. Okay? We replace the existing tower and we do a cell structure at Egypt Beach. Figure 15 shows that we don't equal the same amount of in-building coverage that Tilden Road would present. Tilden Road would present at either 147 or 117. It's less than that. There's actually some more gaps in coverage too. We see some more white areas versus the Tilden Road site. I try to compare back to Tilden Road. So we're trying to see what are the differences. So, all right, what about a two-site solution utilizing the McLaughlin site and Situate Fire Department? And you're seeing the theme here. I'm keeping Situate Fire Department in there because it's an existing tower there. So if you replace the tower, there's something already there, okay? So what possibly might complement that site? And what could we get out of, you know, a two-site scenario? So looking at Edward McLaughlin at 147 feet and at Situate Fire Department 110 feet, we can see that in building coverage, it's better than Egypt Beach, right? Not as good as Tilden Road, okay? It's getting closer though, but it's not. It's still not as good. Okay. Well, what happens if I take the proposed location and I lower the tower? And I go down to 117 feet, and I add in the fire department. Because again, the fire department is giving some in-building coverage down in that coastal southeast area to help augment another site that might not have that coverage in that area. So in this scenario, not bad. We still have some fairly good amount of in-building coverage. We have in-vehicle coverage. We don't have significant gaps in coverage. Is it exactly at what the coverage would be with Tilden Road at 147? No, it's not. You'll see differences north of the site. Because Situate Fire Department isn't going to give you any benefit there. So, what did I conclude from all this? Well, we know there's gaps in coverage today for 18T. We know that the Tilden Road site at 147 feet provides that in-vehicle in-building coverage that addresses their targeted gap area. Lowering the height to 117 feet, it does affect some in-building coverage, especially down in Jericho, Adelaide, Tilden, Beaver Dam areas. Looking at in-building coverage, all those alternative locations that I analyzed did not have the same amount of in-building coverage as Tilden Road. It was less, using a one-for-one comparison. If we go to a two-site scenario, McLaughlin site presents similar in-vehicle coverage, not as good. McLaughlin and the fire department provides similar in-vehicle, but not as good in-building. Lowering the proposed tower to the antennas to 117 feet at the proposed location, adding in the fire department, that more closely makes the in-building coverage more similar to proposed site 147. All right, now. With respect to gas systems, and there was responses by the applicant to Mr. Hutchins' request for what a gas system would look like. The applicant took a look at a 29 site scenario. It doesn't match what Tilden Road would offer as far as coverage. I concur with that, okay? It doesn't match. It's gonna take more sites.
How many more?
A significant amount more. It's not 10% more, okay? It's not, it could be on the order of maybe another 15 or 20 sites to equate to that. gas systems, and, you know, there was a neutral gas system put down in Nantucket for carriers to tie into. DAS has its place, okay? I've done a bunch of DAS systems, as I indicated, in airports and tunnels, et cetera, et cetera. Outdoor DAS systems can work. They can work as a supplement. I have coverage gap areas of a smaller geographical area. It's not necessarily cost effective for me to go build a site to cover a small geographical area when I could tie into an existing site, run communications cable to a DAS system and distribute that signal. One thing you have to know with DAS systems, DAS can be designed to tap off existing sites. So for instance, if you looked at their system today, you know, they have an existing site near Route 3A, identified as NA-1204, okay? So if I were to design a DAS system along the coast, one solution is I have to tap off an existing site. What does that mean? Well, I have to tap off the passive off that site. So in other words, that site is not only handling calls in that area, but now it's handling calls from the DAS system. And I better have enough capacity so I don't busy out phones. If I can't do that, then I have to have dedicated capacity for the DAS. And what does that mean? Well, it means I gotta have RF equipment, I have to have equipment that I can tap into and feed the DAS, okay? The larger the area that you wanna cover with DAS means more people, more phone calls, and more capacity. All right. Existing sites may not have the capacity. They may or may not. Okay, so it may require adding additional to either existing sites or somewhere, additional electronics that would tie into the DAS system. So, you know, can you design a DAS system that will cover that whole coast? You can. It's going to be a lot. It's going to be a lot of sites, a lot of nodes, to get that coverage that the proposed site would have. That's, yeah.
Go ahead.
2 points. One, kind of responding to what I think an audience member asked, that we're opening up a can of worms or the possibility of other private landowners wanting to put towers on their site in order to get coverage. Looking at your various scenarios here, it would appear to me that once we have coverage, there's no benefit to build another tower within a covered area to add a small amount of coverage. I mean, at that point, you might come up with a DAS that would pick up that small amount of coverage. Let's say you had a, let's say for someone, and it doesn't show here, but let's say Front Street, our commercial area, was not covered by Nemeta. What scenario we came up with? You're suggesting a DAS would work to add that section.
Right.
A few nodes, not, you know.
Exactly.
Quarter mile strip of land.
Right, exactly.
Flat.
That's right.
So I don't think we're opening up an issue here by granting a variance outside of our overlay district, should that come to pass. The other question is, you mentioned Nantucket. Are you familiar with the Nantucket?
That went in a long time ago.
Well, the reason I ask is, I spent a lot of time on Nantucket 20 years ago, but there's an enormous tower on the island, about just south of town, or east of town, I guess. And I suppose that was covering most of the island and probably half of the eastern seaboard. I mean, it's huge. It's bigger than anything I've seen anywhere else.
Right.
You know. And to the best of my knowledge, it was, it had cell antennas on it. Am I accurate?
You're accurate. You have to always balance coverage with capacity. because in the cell world, it's different in the old days when I used the comparisons of paging. Before cellular was around, we all had these pagers, all right? Pagers were one-way transmission, and antennas could be on top of mountaintops and blast out to the world, because all I'm doing is pushing data to these pagers, all right? Along from cellular, two-way communication, and the more talk paths, if you will, you know, all of you pick up your phone, you're all using the same subscriber, and you all pick up the phone to come off of the site will only handle so many calls simultaneously. So what they do is they use the terminology to split a cell. So I have a cell that covers, you know, a radius of 5 miles. And now there's just too many people that are using that one site, so I split it in half. And I say, okay, that's where you have panel antennas, you know, that sectorize. You split it up so that I can now add more capacity to the site, and now this capacity only handles 2.5 miles, and then this capacity over here handles 2.5 miles. So in Nantucket, what the thought process was, we're gonna put in a neutral host. We're gonna have a separate third-party company own this DAS system, because, you know, regulatory-wise, permitting-wise, on that island, it's tough, okay? And we're gonna say, hey, we're gonna put in this DAS system, then we're gonna go to Verizon, we're gonna go to AT&T, T-Mobile, so forth and so forth, and say, you pay me monthly, and you get to connect to my DAS. The problem was the cost for the carriers to connect into them was prohibitive. And that's why you didn't see carriers jumping, saying, oh yeah, sign me up, this is perfect, let's do it now.
The testimony we're hearing tonight, your testimony, I appreciate it. It was very concise. I do appreciate your doing the various scenarios. I'm sorry that everyone can't see the maps as closely, but you know, looking at the object here for AT&T is to get coverage, to satisfy the problem of uncovered areas. And you've offered alternative ways to do it. You've shown alternative plans, and you know, it speaks for itself. So. And it's consistent with the testimony we've had in previous hearings, and from AT&T's engineers as well. So it's, but your insight is, thank you.
I have a couple questions.
Sure.
I don't have as much experience as some of the other board members in this, and maybe some of the audience is equally ignorant as I am. So if you would just, the first question is a very practical one. I live way out in the southeast area of the coast here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I have a Verizon cell phone. I'm fine. According to the non-coverage map, I shouldn't be getting anything. Why is that?
Because this is AT&T, not Verizon.
Uh-huh.
So
I picked the right company.
Bingo, man. Bingo, exactly. And what do the companies, the two things that drive the companies in their business is having coverage, okay?
Yeah.
No drop off.
Yeah.
All right, no busies. And, you know, whatever plans they have. They want to get phones in the hands.
So what, that begs the question then, what tower is Verizon using that AT&T isn't
using?
Well,
it could be coming, you know what, it may not be coming from Situate.
Okay.
It may be coming from your neighboring town.
But it don't you see, it leads me to question these maps that I see. As to whether they're in fact telling us there is or is not coverage. We heard the last time, I think it was the last time, about, you know, if you listen to the advertising from all these companies, everybody's covered everywhere. I mean, 99.
Oh, yeah,
and we know, right, yeah. I've heard that's, yes. Well, you know, that's just advertising.
Right.
But I'm not getting, you know, people, I don't know if people who are actually not getting reception in these areas, if a lot of people are just like me. So,
right.
So how can we rely on these things?
Yeah, I can tell you that I have Verizon right now too, and the signal's not great in here. Right?
Oh,
no. Exactly, whoever said in a basement, you're absolutely correct, okay? And the problem is that 15 years ago, the thrust was when your legislators decided in their infinite wisdom, we're gonna auction off spectrum. We need to generate money for the federal government, okay? We're gonna auction off all this spectrum. Companies spent billions of dollars. And they said, all right, we're gonna build out, pave the way, and then every piece of legislation that's come forward, you can't, you know, deny on the health impact. So you got the shot clock, you got, it's on one side, okay? It appears that way, right? The companies need to build out. We need communication. We need to build out. So the first thrust was, we better get the major roads covered. We better get Route 3. We better get Route 3A. Once that first layer happened, the next layer was, okay, now we spread out into residential areas. Now we're getting into the home. Because what's happening now is the phone is replacing your landline, right? And there's more services offered, more data services offered. The other problem is you hear 4G, you hear that buzz, all right, 4G, right. We're implementing 4G. Well, actually, it's technically not 4G that they're doing. They're doing a next generation 3G. When 4G happens, you know, get ready, because that's gonna be even faster. But the drawback is it requires more sites, okay? The faster I push speeds, I need more signal strength, okay? It's physics. I can't, there's just no other way around it. So we knew all along this was going to happen. Now Verizon, okay, the type of coverage that they have in that area may not be their high level of coverage, because the way cell phones work, and I don't know if you ever noticed on your phone, you may see a 3G, you may see a 1X,
right?
You know what that means? That means slower speed,
right?
So as you get further away, you get into a coverage area that's not as good,
3G.
The phone automatically drops down in speed. The companies don't necessarily, they don't want to settle for that. They don't want to say, okay, we'll just give 1X coverage, and that's the speed you're going to get. If there's a lot of people, if there's populace in an area, we want to make sure that we can give them the fastest speed. We can pump the data through. We can do more phones, more data, translates to more money.
So I guess this question may be better for AT&T than for you, but my question is going to be, if I'm getting service in a white area on this map, mm-hmm. and you're saying it may be that Verizon's got a tower in Marshfield that's reaching me,
mm-hmm.
My question would be, well, rather than building this big tower, why don't we put AT&T on that one?
Because I would venture to say that tower is not going to cover that whole white area
okay.
along the coast.
I thought you'd say that, right?
Yeah.
So let me ask you this question then also. So you gave us two scenarios for a 117-foot tower versus a 147-foot
right.
tower. And I see, it appears to me, tell me if I'm misinterpreting your map, that the loss in reception in buildings seems to be in spotty areas, rather than in the circumference. In other words, the size of the circumference really doesn't decrease, but in different areas within the circumference around the tower, you lose some reception, and I'm assuming it's because of elevation changes
right.
or foliage or things like that.
Right.
Is that right?
That's right. We lower the antenna heights.
Okay.
We're going to have more.
Is there any way that we can figure out how many people that is, and whether it would make sense for those areas to put a DAS there?
I would ask you to ask the applicant that.
Okay. I hope they remember that question. I will ask them that question. Because a lot of this is trade-off type of thing.
Right. Absolutely.
So you mentioned that if you go to a DAS system, we need to look at the infrastructure. And you know, if we do, if somebody were to build a big VAS system that would cover a good portion of this coast, we'd need more equipment. Mm-hmm. Can you give us an idea what this equipment looks like, how big it is, and how much we would need?
Well, you're going to have to mount more of the equipment on the poles.
Right.
Okay? More of those nodes, all right? And then, potentially, you're going to need a footprint of maybe 120 square feet to put electronics somewhere. Okay, cabinets,
okay.
Electronics, and that's got to go somewhere. Okay, does it go where their existing sites are? Well, then they've got to modify those leases. I don't know if there's space to do that. I don't know, you know, what's possible to do that. But there's a lot of steps that you have to go through to get there on the engineering side, on the design engineering. Side to do a DAS system. It's not as simple as just let's pluck these up wherever, you know, wherever we see fit and turn it on.
There's been some discussion that the DAS system wouldn't provide, assuming we could afford to build it, that it wouldn't provide coverage to everybody. What is your opinion on that?
It's a problem because of the heights, okay? And it's going to be worse at PCS than 800. Because at 1900 meg, the foliage is going to attenuate that signal drastically. And you're going to need more nodes. And there's no guarantee that you're putting nodes along the streets, okay, on poles. But that may not be where people are. Somebody could be, you know, a couple hundred feet, you know, from a street. 300, 400 feet, whatever, is not going to have coverage.
I've read in some of the material that people can get a booster in their own home to sort of suck in the coverage.
And you know what? I design big systems for in buildings, for basements, underground garages and whatnot that are called booster systems. They're called BDAs, bidirectional amplifiers. Okay. The problem with that is you need good signal coming in to get good signal in the area. Garbage in is garbage out. I can't manufacture something if it's too low in signal. I need to be able to hear something so that I can convey it. It would be, if somebody was standing here and needed to relay the information to somebody down the hall, and you whispered to that person there, they didn't hear you. And then they turned around and said what they thought you said, but it didn't come through. Versus you speaking up louder, okay, I can convey it.
Okay, one more thing and then I'll pass you on to somebody else. Okay. Can we just do a quick comparison of the Wampatuck location and the Children Road location, which I think is figure 10 and figure 13. If I'm interpreting this correctly, the changes in coverage really has to do, it's essentially the same, but it has to do with whether one is further north than the other. And if the one that's further north is going to provide more coverage to the north and less coverage to the south, and vice
right.
versa, right?
Yeah, Wampatuck provides some pretty decent coverage in that southern part. It's not a bad location.
Okay. That's what I thought you'd say. Probably the next best alternative to Wampatuck would be something increasing the height of the fire department, from what I'm interpreting your maps as saying, in combination with a shorter tower on Tilden Road, or maybe even Wampatuck.
But that's not going to get the Bell Kitchen lineup.
You could still going to lose some of the north.
The 147 is doing your best service
north
in the Leonard area.
Right.
I mean, it's also, these are also covering an awful lot of marsh. I mean,
well, and some of the ocean, a good deal of ocean.
Yeah. Long bonus.
Pastor, why, what drove you to choose the, I mean, I know why you've got 147,
why did you choose the 110 for the, for 117? Is there a sort of a...
The applicant had presented some data at 117. I could have gone a little bit lower. I think that if you start getting close to that 100-foot mark, I think you're going to start seeing greater impacts in coverage, degradation because of the foliage and terrain. So that's, again, I'm trying to validate as much as, you know, what is the applicant providing with some scenarios that, you know, I mixed in. But at a minimum, I need to validate what they're presenting you.
I guess what I'm concerned about is that if you get to 147, mm-hmm. what would sort of be, there must be a range that it's covered, you know, so like how much lower can we ask them to drop it and still have decent coverage? At what point is there a significant decrease in the coverage because of the decrease in the height of the tower?
Yeah, and we're talking about a 150 versus a 120 here, antenna height of 147, 117. And I think if you look at the 117 versus...
Is it reasonable to say that a 123 or a 128 would be halfway between? Yes.
Yeah, I mean, typically, yeah, if you go from 147 to 137, it's going to be hard to see a difference on the map. 10 feet, it's not going to show up. So I don't usually drop down. I like to drop 20 or 30 feet down and then look at that impact. So you can say, I mean, it's not like it's drastic difference from 147 to 117. It's not a drastic, oh my God, you know, half the coverage is gone. It affects the in-building more than the vehicle at 117.
But, and keying on something Frank was saying about, you know, doesn't shows a white spot here on the map, but he's got coverage. Mm-hmm. I'm in a white spot, and I have Verizon, and it's lousy. I mean, but I know, I recognize it. I mean, the terrain suggests that I'm not going to get coverage. I worked in a building for a year or so in Foxborough, mm-hmm. on Route 1, and it was in a valley, and there were five big commercial buildings. No one could use had cell service.
Right.
Nobody. And they were asked, people asked to bring in individual antenna, and what they could do was put their own tower up,
right,
as big as, you know, as the other towers, to get up above the terrain to pick up the signals and boost,
right,
it that way. I mean,
right.
So I can appreciate the challenge. But these projections, there has to be a certain degree of, I'm in a green area and I'm still not getting coverage. I mean, they're pretty good.
Yeah, the modeling has gotten so much better over the last, you know, 10, 15 years because there's more data available, more GIS information available, and what we call building data, forest data, the density, the terrain data has gotten down to a better resolution.
So if we used a more refined piece of equipment than our own cell phones to find out where the signal is coming from in this white area.
Mm-hmm.
If you're saying it's a white area under the present scenario, mm-hmm. in your model, you're feeling fairly confident it's probably a white area as far as AT&T's signal is concerned.
For AT&T provide their threshold of reliable.
There may be a signal there, but it's whispering.
There's always that transition, exactly. You know, I mean, it doesn't mean that I go here and it's absolutely dead, but it means that, you know, my reliability, my data speed's gonna drop down, and I may drop a call in that area. And the one thing that carriers can't have is drop calls, because what happens if you have too many drop calls? You go to better bid.
Then under Beacon, I'll tell you.
Unless they're Verizon.
Oh, I am, I'm on under B and, under A and B, neither one.
Well, you know, I'm kind of curious, if we did a map of Verizon?
Mm-hmm.
They'd be different, right?
The coverage would be different, and the biggest struggle you have is if you call up Verizon tomorrow and say, listen, I want information about your tower sites, they're going to say, sorry, we don't give out that engineering information. It's very difficult, and believe me, I feel that pain, because I...
Verizon wants to be on the tower, though, I mean...
If Verizon wants to come in front of the board, then yes, you can say to them, okay, we need your engineering information. But to call them and say, hey, you know, we want to know about you possibly mounting on this tower over here, tell me what, you know, how it would work for you. I mean, I go through that with the companies, and I got to tell you, Verizon is the worst out of all of them. They've had me sign, you know, loads of papers, given away to my firstborn, you know, if I tell the competitor some piece of information.
NSA.
Yeah, right, exactly, like it's some top secret information.
I guess the one question I have too is, do you believe that AT&T has proven that there's a significant gap in their coverage?
Yes, from the information provided and what I ran, I indicated in that white area you can see the gap.
Just one other question too, maybe more kind of layman's term, but you have your text, you're following your data, habit. Now the green area that they have here, is that kind of based on data or phone? Because I know the times I can make a phone call, but I can't get on the internet.
Right.
Or vice versa.
Right.
I can't make a phone call, but I can send someone a text.
The systems being designed now are being designed for data at the threshold, so yeah, that.
So the fact that you might be able to make a phone call doesn't necessarily relate to this data. They're looking for their internet connection to work on their phone.
It's absolutely.
So, yeah. So the fact that
it's
you pick
total,
up your phone call,
it's a total package.
Is it necessary the information you need to, that this is based on?
Right, and understand again that if I'm right next to the site here, and I have a high signal level, I'm going to be able to push data faster than if I'm
it doesn't travel
over here, because the signal strength's a little bit less. I still have reliable signal strength,
right?
But it's just not going as fast.
I have just a quick question, hopefully, regarding the DAS technology. We've talked in prior hearings about co-location and, you know, well, Verizon may have coverage at Frank's house. It's clear from some of the other things on the record that they're interested in this tower site or maybe somewhere else. If there was if AT&T went and put up a DAS system that at however many nodes it is, mm-hmm. Are there the same opportunities for co-location and whatnot that you would see with a tower, or would they have to start from scratch again?
That's what's called a neutral host type DAS. The problem is that if AT&T builds out a DAS system for their equipment, they're not necessarily building it then to support the other carriers that would go on that system. Okay? So it might mean additional electronics that would have to be added to that system to support another carrier.
Correct. So you're talking about not starting from scratch, but not just tacking it on.
Yeah.
And talk at all about the cost of a DAS system. I mean, are we talking more? Are we talking exponentially more? Is that even within your?
I hesitate to throw numbers out because I don't have a design that I
right.
can sit there and say, okay, here's the cost. I'd say ask the applicant what their comparative cost is. They know how much it costs to build a site. I mean, I have an idea of what it costs than to build it.
In your, staying away from specifics.
Yeah.
In your opinion, is it, you're talking extremely prohibitive costs, one versus the other?
Well, I'll put it to you this way. If they have to have electronics capacity for the DAS system, if they can't feed off an existing site and they have to add electronics, the cost just went way up. Because what you're doing is you're telling them, here, put all this ground-mounted cabinet electronic equipment in to feed your DAS system over here. So there's a cost here, and then there's a whole internet cost and electronics cost for the DAS system throughout the area, however many nodes you have. So that's a lot more money than tapping into an existing site and feeding DAS.
Anything else from board members? Okay, let's open it up to the audience. Questions?
Great.
Yeah, great.
Hi, my name is Bill Schmidt. I live at 33 Egypt Beach Road in Scituate. And for the record, I'm a newly appointed member of the Conservation Commission, but I am speaking here as a private citizen. In terms of what we've just seen here, we have demonstrated some gaps in coverage, but correct me if I'm wrong, what we've done is demonstrated gaps in AT&T's coverage, not necessarily coverage in general. Have we established, and Madam Chairperson kind of alluded to it, a significant gap in coverage overall, not just related particularly to AT&T coverage?
No, I mean, I don't know what the other vendors' coverage is.
But it's my understanding that that's not relevant.
No.
It's the issue is AT&T have the significant gap in coverage.
I respectfully disagree, but I will let the legal minds. But there is precedent to say that coverage is coverage regardless. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Anyone else? Yes.
Tracy Shepherd, 34 Cairo Circle. I have two questions, both fairly straightforward. One, just when you're looking at in-building coverage, I presume that the modeling accounts, in an area like Scituate, are you looking primarily with assumptions that we're at wood frame houses versus big compact roof? The second question is kind of a follow on Mr. Tibbetts' question about the need for further building. You talk about, so the area in green or it could be covered and that circle is what it is, adding another tower doesn't change that. But does increased use of technology of these systems, is that going to effectively shrink the covered area? In other words, the greater demand for services in forthcoming years, presuming we have more and more customers, will there be a greater need for coverage?
What drives that is people want things faster and better. And that's what's driving the next generation of data services, because it's all about getting video, it's all about downloading content. I just came from an LTE, you probably heard long-term outage, okay? I just came from a certification training of engineering and planning for LTE systems. And you know what one of the biggest drivers in this 4G is gaming. Okay. That's the audience. They're going after these kids that are going to be able to do things. They don't have to be connected now to their TV or whatnot. They want handsets. They want to be able to do things on the fly. 4G is going to be able to accomplish that. Tremendous amounts of data back and forth. So you're right. It's demand for services, faster. It means I need to have more sites to to equal the level of coverage that I had in 2G or 3G, that throughput.
So just to clarify, adequate coverage today would not necessarily, in a handful of years, be adequate coverage?
I wouldn't say handful. I mean, the data progression, back in 1994, 95, we were talking about 3G. Oh, it's coming next year. Never happened. No, it's coming following year. Didn't happen. It takes a long time for that. So 4G is going to be around a while.
But increased usage, I mean, for example, this year I sit on the couch with my iPad and my iPhone.
Yeah.
And there's more and more of that happening, and that does draw on that capacity, correct?
That's right. That's more phones, more users, more communication to a site.
Is that more towers or more equipment at the tower?
It's more equipment last spectrum that was auctioned by the federal government, it's LTE spectrum. That spectrum gets capacity to these carriers. Okay, so the carriers that had spectrum in the mid-80s, there were two cell carriers, they ate up that spectrum. As they were putting phones out on the street and whatnot, boom, we're having a problem. Nextel is a prime example. Nextel blew up. The explosion was unbelievable, and they busied out. They didn't have enough capacity. So what you see is we'll go to sites and we'll add in capacity to sites. However, we're still limited. I can add capacity to a site. I can increase the speed. But what it means is the person who's on the outskirts of that coverage, he's going to still be able to communicate now. He's not going to have busies, but he's not going to get the higher speed because he's further away. Now, if there's a demand, if there's a lot of people that they deem a demand for that on the outskirts, then maybe we have a site. But it's all business related. It depends. Where are the people? You know.
I guess what I'm getting at is my Comcast, or I see on television, Comcast has a new box that I can talk to and I can do 12 different things and all of it. But it's still just the same box. It takes up the same amount of space
right.
in the house. It just does a lot more than it used to
right.
do.
Right.
Are we building, when we talk about additional need for data or desire for throughput, are we talking about more cell towers or more boxes on the towers or different boxes on the towers?
It's a combination. Because the one thing you can't get away from is the physics. I cannot get away from, if I want to transmit at 1 megabit per second to you, and then I want to go transmit 20 megabits per second wirelessly. Comcast, same box, it's going through, you know, their cable, their fiber, et cetera, et cetera. Wirelessly though, I need more signal. If this stays the same, the path stays the same, I need more signal strength to have that reliable throughput at the faster speed.
But don't you just yell louder at me?
Yeah.
As opposed to having to get three of me to
It would be acquire. Great if we could just turn everything up. The problem is you need to, an excellent point, you need to balance the system. I can be the tower site and I can blast louder to you. How do you blast louder to me? The handsets can only do so much. They can only do so much power. The iPads can only do so much power. They don't transmit at the level that a radio site can transmit. That's your weak link.
So I need closer antenna to what's being, the handset is broadcasting at a lower power.
Oh, right.
So I need a closer antenna to get through.
Right.
To receive.
In theory, yes. That's the theory.
Not a bigger antenna. More.
Yeah, I mean, if you could take your handset and hook it up to an outside antenna and point it at the site, yeah, okay, but that's not the way it operates.
So they'll start marketing antennas that sit in our house that pick up our handsets and then shoot it over to the tower.
There, years ago, there was discussion about fiber to the house, okay, and fiber throughout the house, and you're going to have a box on the outside of your house, and that box is going to transmit back to the cell site. That didn't happen.
But my phone does that now. If it's in Wi-Fi,
mm-hmm.
it takes data on Wi-Fi as opposed to taking it.
Right, exactly. Yep.
Tony, one quick question, and I think Mr. Tibbet brought up, and it's a good point. A lot of the coverage is actually going to the ocean, a fair amount of it. I didn't know if we could look at a plan that, you know, obviously when you lower the tower, the diameter of the circle gets smaller. If you did that and you combined it with some gas system, then maybe you can get better coverage than what the larger circle is doing now, without nearly, I think you thought of maybe 50 units of gas to do the whole coverage, but with a much smaller number of those and have less wasted coverage space, then the tower could be considerably shorter and, you know, and help appease some of the neighbors as well in terms of that. And I think it's pretty obvious that both entities feel that the Wampanoag location and this location are the best of the choices to deal with the coverage. But I didn't know if you combine the two things, that you could actually get more green area on usable space. And is that doable? The big question you said is, does AT&T have the capacity at the site to feed a gas system? Only AT&T knows that.
Right.
But a much smaller gas component could...
That helps with capacity. You're not touching many people with that gas, so the capacity issue is not as great as if you have bigger companies.
And if the tower could go down 30 feet, it's much less of an eyesore and plus some of the other aesthetic issues. So I don't know if there's a way to look at that.
Yes. I guess that goes to your analysis of the alternative sites, correct?
Yeah, there's like I said, there's a lot of scenarios that you could model. I don't know the history on a lot of these other alternatives, so I'm not sure what's viable and what's not. I'd have to look for direction. Somebody's got to tell me, hey, we want to analyze this location. Want to look at this scenario.
But as far as I know, the only real location that was analyzed alternatively was the Wampanoag site, correct?
Well, they were all analyzed.
Well, they were all analyzed, but that was the only other one that was potentially viable.
That was the only one that offered comparable coverage to the Tilden Road site. There was some that just can't be built on our list. I mean, I think we had 29 that we began with. We had some sites. Well, some just can't be built. I mean, it just, they're either wetlands, it's small, or they're not available, from the municipal side of things. But there are some sites that just can't build.
Right. And the town rejected, the selectmen rejected Wampanoag, so it's really off the table.
Not all. What was the reason for that?
Not all. I don't know what the reason was. I don't know if you want to speak to
that. It was a split vote.
It was a split vote on choosing Wampanoag or not. And the split came down to the no. Ma'am.
Robbie Blanger, 26 Persimmon Drive. Sorry to back up for a minute. I want to make sure I'm understanding the colors. So the green is vehicle coverage?
In building.
That's in building.
Right.
The orange is?
The added coverage in vehicle. So in vehicle, in essence, is the green and the orange together.
Okay. So in building is?
Green-orange.
All right. And then orange is just in the car?
Orange and the green would be in your car, yes. The orange is the additive coverage for in vehicle. So it's the combination. It doesn't mean that if I travel into the green area in a car, I don't have coverage.
Okay, I get you.
It's the green and orange.
Orange is the combo.
Right, it's orange and green.
All right, can I ask another?
Yeah, sure.
Going back to what you were saying earlier about, you know, the demand increasing and then the area decreasing as a result of the expanded demand. So say we're 10 years down the road and this tower is now no longer covering the same area because of the increased demand. Would we then be in a position where we're going to another neighborhood, putting in another tower?
It's still going to cover what it shows there, okay? Yeah. What happens is if there's a need for, there's more users, we have to add more capacity to the site. That's the electronics, that's the cabinetry, okay? What it means though is that it's not, adding that extra electronics doesn't benefit the person who's, let's say, you know, on the outskirts of that coverage for speed-wise. They still have coverage, but it's at the same level. It's not improving their speed or their signal strength.
So when you say they would come and add at the base?
Yep, of the tower.
And that would, at the base of the existing tower, so that when the demand is increased to the point where it's pushing the limits, you add more at the base, and then that sort of rebounds up the coverage?
Not the coverage. It allows more data transmissions and calls to go through that site.
Okay, so it keeps the speed at what you're used to.
Right, the speed. The only time that changes if the technology changes, like 4G, and I go to a site and I add 4G, I add faster components, if you will, to allow for faster speeds to the site. And that'll work in that coverage area, but not everybody in that whole coverage area is going to benefit from that top speed. People on the outskirts are just going to have to settle for
that
cluster speed.
So I think that is where I'm confused, though. I'm trying to follow you.
Okay.
So when we're talking about the speeds, I can just envision, you know, Star Trek speeds, okay? And
right.
People start enjoying those.
Right.
Then the companies want to provide it.
Right.
Do you need to then install towers in other neighborhoods in order to get that speed?
The only,
or can you just keep?
No. The only time that you start to see that progression is when next generation equipment, higher speeds, come down the road. And right now, they're designing towards this latest technology, 4G. They're designing towards that level. That's something that's a known quantity that we have equipment suppliers, we have equipment that's built for that. I don't know what 5G is. I don't know what 6G is. I don't know when it's coming, you know? I'm probably not gonna be in this business when that comes. I'm gonna be retired hopefully somewhere. It's so far down the road that it's too hard to speculate.
So I think I have two more questions. Is that all right? I'm just trying to understand. Okay, so I'm trying to visualize. I'm a visual person, so bear with me. Sorry.
No problem.
So, we're at that point where we need the speed to increase, and they're coming in and they're adding to the base station.
Mm-hmm.
So how does that work? Does it go up or does it go out? How does that expand?
No. It's electronics.
That are just replaced?
They're replaced or added to, and they utilize, and what they sometimes might do is swap out antennas on the pole, but they're not adding double the antennas, you know, the technology is getting better now with the antennas that you can do multiple things with one antenna now. You know, years ago, it was one thing, one antenna. Now it's multiple things, one antenna.
Okay, so I have one more question.
Sure.
Okay. I'm looking at new maps here, and I'm looking at figure 8 and figure 2. And it looks to me, when we were talking about combos, alternatives, I think both of these are town-owned properties, so the money would be smarter to go to town. So I'm looking at, on figure 8, that north section that is orange.
I see that it's mostly green on two, so I'm wondering if there was a combo of figure eight and figure two, both town-owned properties, the town would get the money, you would increase the coverage area. And then I see you still have down by the lighthouse some orange.
Yeah.
Which, that's the combo though, right?
Yeah, the problem with those two locations, they're so close to one another that the majority of the added coverage is minimal. The majority of the coverage is duplication.
And I'm sorry, I did have one more, and then I'll stop. From my understanding, you know, to achieve coverage, and maybe you're not the person to ask, my understanding is that the law understands that 100% coverage is not achievable, possibly, and that a reasonable coverage could potentially be, for instance, Niagara Terrace. Do you agree with that?
I love that question. What's reasonable? I leave that up to lawyers to determine what's reasonable.
We usually leave it to juries. Okay. In the back, yes, sir.
A couple of questions.
Can you push your name and your address?
My name is Bob Carson. I live at 4 Cairo Circle. I'm not sure how many players are in this arena. Verizon, T-Mobile, AT&T, are there any others?
No. I'm not sure what you're talking about. This application is just AT&T.
Well, this application's right. It's just for AT&T.
Correct.
And with the precedent that I'm seeing here is that AT&T is going to be in the backyard of someone's private residence. So if say it's the big five, for lack of a better number, you know, of players in this arena, if anybody else comes to you, we're going to go through the same process. If somebody, where I'm going is that, are we creating kind of an auto mile on Tilden Road of tower backyards? So if AT&T builds a tower, you approve their process, they build the tower, it's going to be unlikely that you're going to share this with Verizon. Is that correct?
Well, no, I think it's quite the opposite.
You will share it with Verizon.
First of all, he's not sharing anything with anybody.
Yeah,
he's
right.
He's
that's
been, no, he's
he doesn't work for AT&T. He works for us.
Right.
He works for us.
He's
the
working
town
for us.
Has hired him. He's the expert to, he's the peer review.
Right.
So
well,
AT&T is looking to.
Would AT&T share that with Verizon?
Yes.
Yes, it's cost effective for both of them to do that.
So AT&T can build or include all the other competitors or that they wish.
Yeah. Maybe you can remind us how many people can how many providers can co-locate on the tower that you're designed?
The different stages of the tower.
The bigger the tower, the more co-location too.
Yeah, and you know,
so
okay.
One tower,
wait a minute. Okay, let's let Mr. Perry answer the question.
All right, so this has, I don't know if this is a big five, but let's assuming there's five. This tower is designed for five carriers. You'll see at each of the grant levels, there are antennas back there, so there are five slots for carriers. One part of the discussion I want to point out is the logic of reducing the height of the tower. So if we build this tower at 100 feet, first of all, you'll have testimony that doesn't work for us.
Okay.
But if you bring it down to 100 feet, Verizon's going to go find another place and build a tower. So there is a trade-off. When you reduce the height, you reduce those co-location slots that are feasible for a carrier. So if this site was built at if AT&T was at 147, Verizon could go 137. AT&T is at 117, Verizon's going at 107, if that provides adequate coverage. If not, they'll look for another site to build, and you'll be facing the same dilemma.
Gotcha.
We have a significant gap, we can't use this to close it.
So where's 147?
But the gentleman in the audience was asking how many you have
five.
Co-location for five, so four of your competitors.
Could
with lease space on your tower.
Correct.
Could.
Correct.
And you'd be willing to do that.
Oh, absolutely.
Because it generates money to offset the cost of the
tower.
And
it's also required of your bylaw that if we're going to build a tower, we need to build it with the maximum number of pieces, maximum users that are known today. And if Verizon came in and wanted to build a tower 300 feet away from this, I cannot imagine
that the board's not going to say, no, you go use the tower that we approved. That's why your high school tower is loaded up. The town decided, here's where it goes. You, if we build it, they'll come.
Are you on the high school tower? Do they communicate on it? Is it right there? Okay, so I may be getting ahead of myself, but the question I asked earlier is, what tower is it that I'm getting reception on that you're not on?
You're on Verizon.
Pardon me?
You're on Verizon.
Right. But for us, so there's got to be some tower that's feeding my cell phone at my house that's in this white area that AT&T is not on, if I understand the logic of this co-location.
Well, not necessarily we may be on it. Our coverage may not be reaching, at least according to the propagation maps. My guess is, in this area, if there are towers, they've got to be loaded up. I don't know every tower in the area, but I cannot imagine there's a single carrier pole anywhere in this area.
But shouldn't we be sure that you are not ignoring another available tower before we build one?
Absolutely. If you look at our materials, you'll see we've looked at numerous first of all, there are very few existing structures.
Yeah.
We don't know where Verizon's located, but if you tell us that you want us to determine whether we're located on XYZ Tower, I'll get to that information.
Okay, maybe good. You could tell us in this whole south, you know, Cohasset, Hingham, Norwell, Marshfield, where all your towers are. Would that kind of work? I mean, that kind of answers the question.
They're in there.
You have
all those towers.
All right. So in the application, what page? I mean, which
section 4.
So that shows all your...
The back in section 4.
Go back in section 4.
All these. It's the same ones that are on this, though, too.
Okay.
And what they're proposing, what's existing, what's not.
Okay, all right.
You have our, what's it called?
Exhibit 7 of your page, exhibit 7 of exhibit 4.
Where are you looking here?
Yeah. It was provided in the original RFA
yep.
dated November 19th. Exhibit 1 is an AT&T network plan.
Oh, that one's. Yeah, that's it. Exhibit 1. That's the ability. So section 4 is the RF.
Actually, it's on exhibit. Exhibit 7.
Okay, can we just keep it down here so we can hear? Where is it?
Exhibit 7.
It's on exhibit 1 in the November 19, 2010 report. And
if I can write, if you take a look at tab 4,
yeah. Yep, that's where we are.
Can I go to exhibit 1? It's a white map. It's going to be the first map
yep.
in the narrative.
With it.
So those are all the sites in the various towns.
Okay,
our site number is an MA and it's followed by 4 digits.
All right, so does that answer your question, Frank?
Well, we don't know what Verizon is, so I'm not.
No.
I can't answer
it. Yeah, but it doesn't answer the question, no.
It doesn't?
No.
Yeah.
But is it in your reviewing proposed AT&T sites, you've considered existing towers where you might co-locate?
Yes.
In addition to those where you would build a new tower.
That's correct, and you'll see in Dan Villazikian's alternative site analysis, if there were any in the area that we could attach to provide coverage, we would have.
That was my recollection.
Exactly.
It's in there at some point.
That's in tab
5. Those are just AT&T sites.
Well, that's where they currently have.
But if
there aren't any, I mean, there's, for example, I know there's a tower out on Route 3 about one, just south of 129, it's not on this map, 139. Because it's on Route 3, I imagine you're on that tower. It's off this map and it wouldn't do anything to cover our territory anyway.
So in other words, if there was a tower that was outside of the existing AT&T sites, there's no sense in us looking at it because obviously the AT&T sites are closer to the coverage gap
when they don't cover it, and they're on the air, then anything outside beyond them is not going to cover.
But it's your testimony, and I seem to recall it in our previous discussion, that if I look at this exhibit one, there isn't an existing structure, tower, on which AT&T could co-locate.
Correct.
That would improve the coverage in this area.
That would improve the fit, meet the targeted coverage objective for that area, correct.
What is the tower that Verizon is on that's giving service to Situate Harbor?
I'd have to go out to your location with equipment or
AT&T.
And I would have 13. To have the PN information from Verizon, and then I could tell you what tower it's coming from. But that's, I can't tell you right here today what tower, the coverage on your Verizon phone with that's already made.
There's two big towers in Marshfield that would go right across, that would probably project across the marsh, though. But you're on.
But you know, said, I know I've made a statement in the past, it's not a popular thing, but this is also about competition. So we share structures, we share framework, we don't share signal, we don't share customers, we compete for customers. So that's what drives the price down. That's why we don't pay long distance anymore, along with a mobile phone. So the whole point was to drive competition. And Congress decided that's what we're going to do. Competition is capital, and capital gets invested, and people get returns. So it is a business, and it's a competitive business.
Does that kind of help answer your question?
Well, yes and no. Where I'm going is that you're setting a precedent here for putting a tower in someone's backyard as opposed to putting it on public property. Are there any cell towers on? Obviously on public property, and the answer is yes at the town hall, yes at the fire station, I'm not sure where else. And my question is, you know, it would be great to have the cell towers in a more situated in a strategic way. I introduced that word at the last meeting, and I'm not sure, you know, it came across with the impact that I was hoping for, but you know, what's the strategic plan to serve all of Situate? I asked the question, what's the percentage of Situate being served by, I guess, AT&T today? And I think the percentage that was raised at the last meeting was 36. Does that sound? Or does anybody remember that?
I mean, that's the applicant question.
I asked the question of whoever the presenter was, and I said, what will the coverage be as a result of this tower? And the number that was presented, if my memory serves me correctly, was 70%. And that sounds grand and great that we're all being included, but it's really not all. It's just AT&T will be able to serve 70% of the town. And hopefully it would expand, you know, for all the other carriers. I would be interested in finding out what the percentages of coverage are from the other carriers, especially in terms of how they're being served, probably through the police station, which seems to be the main tower. So I think the precedent that we're setting here is doing something in somebody's backyard, as opposed to something that is on town property, where town property can receive the financial benefit, as opposed to some relationship between a private citizen and a vendor. Item last is, you're setting a precedent, and I urge you to reconsider this. If it wasn't good enough for Wampatuck, why is it good enough to have in the backyard in Tilden? Maybe, I'm not sure what the dynamics were, I wasn't involved, I apologize for not being more involved, but if it impacted, say 450 kids or whatever the number is at Wampatuck, what difference does 450 kids make versus say 100 for round numbers in the Tilden metropolitan area? So
I'm not sure what the arguments are, but I urge the board to explore it. And if that means setting up a private or a separate committee to take a look at this, to help you, to augment your work, I would strongly urge that. Thank you.
Well, thank you. And I think, first of all, it needs to be really clear that Wampatuck was presented to the Board of Selectmen, and it didn't pass. That didn't go before us. We have to deal with the applications that were before us. We started this process in 2010, was it? 2009? 2010. And Wampatuck was hotly debated at that time, and there was a lot of discussion on everything you said. And I'm sure a lot of you were here. But the truth is that when it most recently went back to the Board of Selectmen to make Wampatuck available, they voted it down. So this is what we have to deal with.
And I think it's also important to understand, this isn't a precedent about public-private land. The three main towers on Route 3A in Scituate, one of them is on private and two of them are on public. There isn't a cell tower at the fire station. There's a radio tower at the fire station. The cell towers are at the police station, which everyone loves to say it's at the police station. It's at Town Hall, it's at the high school, and it's in spitting distance of Cushing School. I don't personally know what the difference between the safety issues of that tower and, matter of fact, last meeting when we were discussing the size of the buildings, the structures that needed to control it, and the noise that they made, if we were in the selectmen's hearing room where we often meet, I'd say, it's right there. Literally, right there. We drive by it every day. Nicole.
My pregnant takes, pregnant next to it.
And she takes her lunch and takes a walk around it. We live with these things. And I fully appreciate the concerns about in my backyard. And it will be in someone's backyard, but if it's in Wampatuck School, it's in someone's backyard. If it's at the fire station, it's in someone's backyard. I appreciate the idea of raising money for the town by being on town-owned land. But the bottom line is, the towers are a part of the apparatus which we have learned to live with. The apparatus we have learned to live with have undisclosed health issues, unclear health issues, depending on who you want to read. And all of those things are out there. But until everyone in this room wants to take their phone and drop it in the toilet, we have to hear this. And we have to provide the service to everyone in this town. And there's going to be a tower built somewhere, probably, unless we can come up with an alternative way or show that there's sufficient coverage. And that's what we're here to listen to. So we're not setting precedent. There's nothing new here. We have previously heard, the only reason those towers on 3A didn't come before this board is they're not zoning violations. They're within the wireless overlay district, which we created. Somehow, in the wisdom of the town, we said, hey, it doesn't matter if it was in your backyard, if you live near 3A, it's there. That's what the town said. What we're talking about is the overlay district isn't sufficient to cover the town. So we're basically spot zoning because we're told we have to with the variance.
I think, can I just emphasize Sarah's point? This board does not decide where these towers go. We just have to deal with the applications as they come before us. And the selectmen or other property owners who may convince AT&T or whatever other carrier, build one here or build one there, it's really up to them. And if there is another alternative out there, one of the basics of that alternative has to be that the owner of the property is willing to have it on their property. Right now, as it presently stands, and I don't know what the present composition of the Board of Selectmen's views on this are, because the board has changed, but if that alternative is going to be pursued, you need to bring it to the selectmen, because we don't get to say, oh, we think Wampatuck is a better location, put it there. That's out of our control if the owner of Wapentake doesn't want it.
We did that at the last go-around.
Essentially.
And AT&amp;T supported us and supported our ideas here and proposed it to the town, and the town went along with it, and the town and it pursued it, and then AT&amp;T decided it wasn't the right time to pursue a tower in Situate. At least, is that my understanding?
That's my best understanding also.
So that we came back to this, and unfortunately there was that gap in time because, or we're having this hearing again because at this time, AT&amp;T no longer has the option to go to Wapentake, which you were further down the road on the Wapentake side, I think, on completion.
Yeah, I think we were close when we came back to Situate. We approached the town first, which we did here. We went in and said, not just Wapentake, we said, here are, you know, 20 town-owned sites that may work for us if we could put a poll in. Which ones do you like, which ones do you not like? They said, we don't like any of them, this is fine. We came forward with this application. Board said, hey, work with the town, try Wapentake. We tried it. We withdrew, but our first approach was to go back to Wapentake. And that's when it got rejected. And in fact, at the first hearing, as I stated, we weren't the winning bidder. The RFP came out. My understanding is that competitor that begins with a B outbid us on the lease payment. So they would actually be the ones sitting here today presenting Wapentake School to you. It wouldn't be us. When that was rejected, AT&amp;T said, well, you know, I've watched the hearing for the Board of Selectmen meeting. It was predictable. They were predicting what was going to happen. I sat there and watched it online, over the internet. And they said, look, if we don't approve this, these other guys, AT&amp;T is going to come back in here on the Tilden Road site. So, they, you know, everyone knew what was going on and exactly what would end up occurring. So they predicted exactly what would happen when they voted no. AT&amp;T said, we need a site, pursue it, and we bought this.
I'm kind of curious. You may not know the answer to this, but so you're saying Verizon was the winning bidder?
Well, it was never. They were never awarded, but bids get bought. You have to. Everything's competitively bid. There was a minimum bid price established in the RFP. AT&amp;T was not the highest bidder, so I can't say that Verizon was awarded. No, that we were not the highest bidder.
Okay.
99 times out of 100. It's going to go to the highest bidder. And I would have expected Verizon would have received the award, it would have gone to town meeting, which has the exclusive authority of the town property to lease and to grant the necessary utilities. And so I'm very confident that Verizon would have been the company receiving the award.
But Tilden Road doesn't have, because it's private property, doesn't have the same process, is that what you're saying?
It's a direct negotiation. It's like we're renting, you know, a room in an apartment.
Questions? I don't know, I pointed to both at the same time. I'm sorry, I screwed that up.
Just correct me if I'm wrong, but first of all, to back up a little bit, there is a picture of a gas substation in that booklet that we gave you, which is in the course of that. But correct me if I'm wrong, that this updated 1996 FCC law, it allows AT&amp;T to present an application to you. You cannot deny them wireless service, but you can dictate to them or put them in the direction that you want to go. And I hear that gas is very expensive and a lot of money, but that's really not your problem, that how expensive it is. It's really not the board's problem how expensive it is for gas. It's what you see, whether it's a lower tower and partial gas. But the expense shouldn't be any of our concern. That's up to them to put the bills at the expense of that. It's up to you to sort of dictate, not deny them, but to dictate to them or push them in the right direction as to how you want to see yourself as a leader.
Yes.
Go ahead, please. You know, just to say, I mean, there's obviously a line there, right? If I say you have the right to buy food, but a bag of chips is $1 million, that's an effective prohibition. Now, there's multiple shades of gray there, but I think we should acknowledge that. To a certain extent, saying you only have this one option that's more expensive, if it's that much more expensive, I think many people would agree that that can amount to a prohibition.
just something to keep in mind on that.
If I may.
Yes.
The FCC dictates the coverage requirements in the technology, and I presented the case law, and I'm not going to argue legal points. The bottom line is, the board has no jurisdiction to tell AT&T how to deploy or what technology to use, and that includes DAS. But we understand that we're not putting something invisible in a commercial zoning district. We're putting something that's very visible in someone's backyard. We acknowledge that. There are limitations to DAS that we've discussed, and we're kind of going all around the issue. And I would suggest, let us answer some of the questions rather than keep poking at what it is, because based on those questions, we asked Dan to design what a DAS system might look like and what it, how many nodes there would be and what it might cost. So if we could switch to Dan for a few minutes.
Sure. I mean, I think that would that make sense? So you're still going to be here and you can answer the...
I'm not going anywhere.
Okay, good. Well, we're all going somewhere in 20 minutes, and I want to make sure you don't need to come back.
Okay.
What I'd like to do, there were some alternate technologies that came up since the last meeting in May, the last hearing. So what I did was...
You just speak up and turn it away.
There were alternate technologies that came up during the last, after the last meeting in May. People emailed the town. The town forwarded those questions to us. And so what I did here, one of them that came up was, I have a little bit of number of these, so I'm just trying to pass them out and spread them around. What I'd like to do is, I'm going to talk about the DAS. What we did was, we took the footprint, the approximate footprint that we have designed with the proposed tilting site. And the question was, well, how many DAS nodes do we need to get that equivalent coverage or close to it? So I had last time shown you an old DAS design that somebody came up with, a 29-node design that didn't cover nearly what we needed it to cover. So what we did was we did this exercise. We ran the analysis on how many nodes it would be required to get the same thing.
The number came up to be 77. Now, some of the issues that came up was, well, how come other places like Palo Alto, California, can do an outdoor DAS, and AT&T can't do one in situ? Well, those handouts that I just gave you, if you look at those real quick, just to show you the difference, I believe I said at the last hearing that there are applications for outdoor DAS. We do it all the time. Ivan talked about it. My company does outdoor DAS designs. They're designed for covering high density populations in discrete areas. Central Artery Tunnel, we mentioned Fenway, Gillette Stadium, Yankee Stadium, hospitals, college campuses. We do it all the time. Doing situate, an outdoor DAS in situate, there's a number of things that you have to have in place. Number one, you have to have the infrastructure. You have to have the fiber to the utility poles. And I had mentioned, when you drive through situate and you look at your utility poles, I just picked out a couple of examples here, but if you look at figure 7.
I'm sorry, which? I don't know that I'm...
Oh, that's... They're all...
No, this is, they're all different. This is the Palo Alto one, this one you just handed me. Is the one in... Oh, okay, page seven, right.
Oh, that's the old one.
Exhibit seven, which is on page 10.
Exhibit seven, page 10. Is everybody on the same one as the Palo Alto, California?
They don't have any more. So if you look at figure 10, is, that happens to be where one of the nodes in our design was. And figure 8 on the next page is another node. So it's node 4 and node number 40. But all I'm trying to show you here is, look at the height of the telephone pole relative to the trees. Now, if you go back a page, and you look at the telephone poles in Palo Alto, and you look at the height of the poles relative to the trees and the tree density, okay, you can see the canister, that's the antennas, that's the DAS antennas, and the boxes that you see down below in the figure to the right, that's the equipment for the DAS. They mount on the pole. Now, I'm kind of working you backwards here, but...
What's the average height of the telephone pole?
35 to 40 feet.
Okay. So it's larger trees, or higher than that, you would have a problem.
The trees are typically in this area. They're going to be in the 75 to 85 foot range, and even some of the white pines get higher than that. Now, figure 1 on page 4. That's an aerial view of not all of Scituate, but it's an aerial view of the portion of Scituate that we're trying to cover with the proposed macro site. And it's the same area of Scituate that we did this DAS design. Now in comparison, if you flip over to the next page to figure 2, that's Palo Alto. Figure 3 happens to be a zoomed in view of where one node is on Waverly Street in Palo Alto. And then the next figure, figure 4, shows you what the neighborhood looks like from street view. And again, you see, if you compare this to Scituate, there's no comparison. And again, look at figure 5. That's another area in Palo Alto within the same DAS network that they have deployed or planning to deploy. Now, they have when they finish all four phases of their design, I think they're going to end up with 80 nodes. Those 80 nodes cover over 65,000 people. The population of Scituate is in the range of 18,000. Plus. So, as I said, you use a DAS network in areas of high density. We need 77 nodes in Scituate, which would cost in excess of $3 million. And that cost is just the infrastructure. That doesn't include the recurring cost of leasing the right-of-way for each pole. Leasing, you have to lease from Verizon, you have to lease from the electric company, you have to have right-of-ways. Then if a pole doesn't pass the structural because it's too old, and you've got to replace the pole, then there's replacement costs on that specific pole. So the cost per node just for the fiber plant to get fiber to those poles and put the plant in place, that's $40,000 per node. So when you're talking 77 nodes, and I did not include nodes for areas where we already had coverage from another site. So you're talking in excess of $3 million without counting the recurring costs. And the other important thing is, this was designed for AT&T. when you get multiple carriers on a neutral host DAS node, and Ivan backed me up, I did this assuming AT&T is going to be the only one on the node, meaning the output power that I use to get that coverage, that's the full power per node. But now if you add three or four other carriers to each pole, because they want T-Mobile, Verizon, Sprint, wants to tie into this DAS system, every MATA can either be created or destroyed, so every time you tap in and you've got to split that power, you reduce the effective output power for each carrier. So now what you've done is you've shrunk the footprint and opened up all kinds of gaps. So now you need more nodes. I don't want to go on it, but it is, I'm just trying to make the point that an outdoor DAS system in Scituate, and I did look into the Wellesley DAS, that's another issue that came up. Wellesley DAS was a proprietary eight node DAS that T-Mobile did. I'm not sure why they did it, I don't have that information. But they did eight nodes. It wasn't intended to cover the town. There is an RFP out to cover the town of Wellesley with 70 nodes. Now, I don't know who did the design. Do you know about this? I don't personally know who did the design. I find it hard to believe that you could do a neutral host in Wellesley with only 70 nodes, because I tested Wellesley myself years ago for an unnamed carrier. I won't say the name. And it was a 54 node design, and it was only to do a small area of Wellesley. But right now, the way that RFP is, it was awarded to somebody, but it's still in lease negotiations, because that entity that won the RFP really only wants to do along the railway. They don't want to do the whole town. So they're negotiating back and forth. The other issue, Mr. Hammond? No, it was Mr. Lynch. We talked about these boxes that you can put in your house. They're called femtocells. And what it does is it's a consumer item. You purchase it for a couple hundred dollars, and it ties into your internet, cable internet service that you have in your house, and you get wireless coverage on your phone. The minute you leave your house and go outside, you drop that call. It doesn't provide, it's a consumer item. For example, my daughter lives in a basement apartment in Manhattan. She has no coverage. So she would go out and get a femtocell, because the only place she really needs coverage and doesn't have it is when she's in her apartment, and she doesn't have a landline phone. So she's a good candidate, but she's an isolated case. But you're not going to have all of the customers, potential customers in Scituate, tell them to go out and spend $250 on a femtocell so that they can have service in their house. It's not exactly competitive. And they would not have it outside their house.
And they'd have their cable.
Pardon?
They'd have to have cable.
And they'd have to have cable.
I have one.
You have one, right?
So I do.
And does that make
it? It works similar to how you're saying.
Okay. So I covered the outdoor DAS. I wanted to go over that with you. We did look at the fire station, and to answer the question about the 36%, and the 70%, he was very accurate. We said yes, if the proposed site, the Tilden Road site, will bring us to covering 70% of Scituate. Doesn't mean AT&T doesn't want to cover the last 30%. That was the fire station. If you remember last time I was here, I mentioned the fire station to the south, down by the Marshfield border. There's a search ring that AT&T has for that. It's off of this map. This southern portion down here in Scituate.
Humrock Fire Station.
What is it?
I believe it's the Humrock Fire Station.
Yes. And AT&T approached that fire station to replace that tower, and they weren't interested. We did look at the other fire station for this ring. In fact, here it is right here. Problem is, this fire station is very close to the existing AT&T site, so a lot of the coverage from this fire station would be redundant, and it doesn't get all this area that we need. So we did look at it. I had many conversations with Captain Donovan, very nice guy. And of course, you know about Wampatuck, which we know that story. But I wanted to just present the outdoor DAS, show you the photos. For the record, I can...
And we had, Captain Donovan had sent us, or sent me an email a few months back. We did look at it, we responded, and that letter was submitted electronically to the board. You have copies, we could, you know, we may be interested in the future, but it's not going to replace the site.
Do you have any comments on what Ben just said?
There's nothing in there that's, that I disagree with.
Okay. Yes.
Why did your dream have much more coverage than Ivan's dream?
We use different models. Ivan's not using the same prediction tool that we're using.
No, I'm going to ask that question. I've got that one. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, there's, you know, he uses one prediction tool, we have another prediction tool. We know that this, we did tune our prediction tool with using actual drive test data that we collected. So we did a drive test in situate. You hook up an antenna on a crane, I think we talked about that, and then you put out a known effective radiated power and a known channel, and you drive around all these rows, and you collect the received signal strength from that antenna at that height on that crane. It simulates a tower. And then we take that information and we use it to make sure our models are accurate. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. You have one total note there, that one, right? I can't see it.
We have in the, I think in the first,
okay.
I don't know, did I divide it into the drive test data over the predicted. I don't know if we ever provided it. Oh, and the only other thing I wanted to bring up, just to kind of compliment what Ivan said, the question came up, what happens down the road when you need additional capacity? And everybody's using broadband, and everybody wants higher speeds, because these green here, to answer that other question, this is voice and data. So obviously, if you're in an area of in-vehicle coverage and you have a weaker signal, your throughput data rates are going to be a lot slower than if you're in a green area that has a stronger signal. Now, right now, carriers are deploying now and have been deploying for over a year for 3G. And what that involves is, yes, it's additional equipment at the site. It used to be you needed one antenna for PCS, one antenna for 800, one antenna for 750, and one antenna for AWS technology, which is 2100. Now you can buy antennas, the carriers can purchase antennas that are dual band, tri-band, and even quad band. So they take where they might have had four antennas per sector, so 12 antennas total. They take two of them down and they put two dual band in. You know what I mean? They keep changing. Companies, antenna manufacturers know what the carriers need, and they're improving the antenna technology. You can't boost the power because the base stations have a limit. It's not like, oh, I only have 20 watts, I think I'm gonna crank it up to 40. You can't do that. It's 20, that's it. But that's what they do. They've been in AT&T, as I stated in the report, the way they're addressing capacity is they're using 800 cellular frequencies that they have a license for. That's their primary, that's what all this stuff is. Then they have a license for 1900 PCS, so what happens is when you make a call, it tries to put you on 1900. If it can't put you on 1900 because you have weak signal, because the footprint for 1900 is a lot smaller, then what it does is it bumps you down to or up to 800 cellular. But the idea is where the piece, they have PCS and cellular at the same site. So if they can, they'll put you on the PCS channel to offload the cellular subscribers, because the cellular has a bigger footprint, so it's going to grab more subscribers. And so they're doing things of this nature with the technology they have and the licenses they have to address not only capacity today, but capacity 5 years from now. And that, unless you have questions.
You know, it's after 10 o'clock, and the one thing I want to make sure is that any questions that anybody has for Ivan, well, first I'll ask the board, any further questions for Ivan? And for the audience, this is, I just, yeah, get some questions for Ivan, so you won't have to come back.
John Reed, 331 Tilden. So I still have 77 notes.
Sorry.
AT&T's testimony, but I believe Ivan said around 45, 49 notes. Why is such a big difference?
What I think I said was it's substantially more.
It's 15, 20.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, because I haven't done a full design, so I'd have to go through the process of doing a full design. I wasn't asked to do a good design.
Anyone else?
Yes.
Why is the consultant only available for this meeting?
Why is he? It's yeah. Just that if we can finish with him, we let him go to bring him back. Because he was requested to do a review, peer review. He's done the review, and I'd just like to be able so we don't have to have him come back and have the expense of having him come back. So if everybody's done, then we're done. I'm sorry? Oh, I'm sorry. She needs to get your name.
I'm sorry. Bill Schmidt, 33, to be sure.
Yes, sir.
John, does the consultant have a percentage coverage for all the alternative sites? AT&T said 70% for 361 Tilden.
I know.
Percentage for all the alternative sites compared numerically with, instead of looking at a little green here, a little brown here. Yeah. If another alternative site is 68% covered, a little less, that would still be deemed adequate coverage.
And you said you don't
have? I don't have the percentage. I did not calculate that.
Okay. And what does it take to calculate that?
Basically, I have to go back in and create a boundary of the town of Scituate and then run an analysis that shows a percentage of that geographical boundary covered two scenarios, existing and then with the additive of the new site added.
But looking at the maps, you can see which one comes next closest, and then the next one after that is pretty obvious, right?
That's generally what I do.
That's what I thought.
Anyone else? Yes.
Tracy Shepard, I'm not sure if this question is for Mr. Boulay or Mr. Hicks. I don't know if that's misconstrued. But when we're talking about percentage covered by the various scenarios, are we referring to land area or homes or people on the ground or users? Because of course there's an awful lot of blank land there. So to say we go from 36 to 70 something, land versus actual individuals covered may be very different.
We don't include the water. I mean, you can't do anything about coverage if it's out over the water.
Right.
Nothing there to stop it. So it's POPs to answer your question. So we have databases that tells us where the percent of population on POPs, where the people are. And so what it tells me is when we do the POP counts, and we do both, area and POPs. I don't like to use area because it's insignificant to me. What do I care if it comes to Mari?
is on the old marsh. So if one covers 3 miles, square miles, and one covers 2.5, does that mean the 3 miles better? No. It's what we look at as the tops. And what it came down to was the Tilden Road site covers more tops than any of the other alternatives. And that's what we're trying to do. And when we did that analysis, I didn't use in vehicle coverage. I'm talking about people in homes and buildings. So, and the top cones that we have, by the way, aren't in the business anymore. It's based on the 2000 test.
The
30-something
to
70-something
is using your POPs.
Yes,
yeah.
That was a POP count.
Excellent. Okay. Yes, sir.
15 seconds. Off question, four-hour circle. As an AT&T stockholder, I would urge AT&T to work with the board and the people of the town to develop a strategic plan. I'd be happy to help and participate in any way I can.
And as AT&T's representative, that's what we're trying to do.
Mr. Pegasek, thank you.
Thank you.
It was very helpful, and I guess
looks
that's
like
it.
Looks like we're going to continue.
Yes. Well, first of all, I think what we'd like to know is what can we expect next time from AT&T?
I think at this point, very little. I mean, I would conclude our remarks, point out or try to address any of the legal questions or comments that the board may have. I know that the abutters are represented by counsel. I don't know if they intend to do a presentation or if they're here to listen. So from my perspective, we're kind of done with the evidence portion, unless, again, if there are questions, if you have questions now that we can address when we come back, we'd be happy to do so. Or I don't have a whole heck of a lot, at least pure evidence to present.
Okay, who are you going to bring with you next time?
Well, I hate to travel without Dan because it's such a fun ride for him down there. I think the key is to understand what the board is interested in, because that's who we're presenting to. So if you tell me you may have questions for Dan, I prefer that you take the ride so that we don't have to deal with another hearing because he wasn't here. So
right.
Dan Bilzekian will be with me, who's our site acquisition. Our court reporter, and I would say Dan Goulet would be the extent of our, and not necessarily presenting, I probably, as I always do, probably the most important.
One of the things I wanted to ask you was, I know you did the additional balloon test photographs for the Mass Historical Commission.
Yes.
Have you received, obviously I assume that they've been sent to them. Have they responded?
I doubt it.
No, we're not through with that process yet.
Okay.
Yeah, the historic process, you know, AT&T, just so we understand what this process is, as a federal licensee,
right.
AT&T is subject to what's called Section 106 of NHPA, so it's the National Historic Policy Act. So every one of our sites goes through a screening process. Some are excluded, but I would say all towers are included. So they go through this historic process, identifying locations. Mass Historic is the State Historic Preservation Office. So in our world, they're called SHPO. SHPO, we submit every site that's not excluded to SHPO for their review, among others.
Is that an architectural review?
Historic,
okay.
Right, so.
Historic basically. Site, but that's not what, you're not talking about the same people you did the photos for, are you?
I am.
Oh, you
are? So as part of that process, Mass Historic came back and said, can you look at alternatives? Can you screen the tower?
Right.
So and they asked for specific photos and photo simulations. They deal with this all the time. So they sort of know what to ask us for. They came back and said, we'd like to see photos from those eight locations, please do a balloon test and submit. So it's a little outside the zoning process, but they certainly have jurisdiction over it. So that's why Ben came out, flew another balloon, and we submitted those. So again, the only reason I gave those was because it was another opportunity for you to see what the photo simulations will look like from those targeted locations that MHC asked for. And because people probably wondered, why the heck are they doing another balloon?
Okay. Yes, Mr. Sirkin, Attorney Sirkin.
I know it's past 10 o'clock, but I have some remarks that will not take me more than 10 minutes. If it's 10 minutes, you can cut me off, but it might give the board...
It might give the board
something to think about between now and when we come back. And so I would ask your indulgence for 10 minutes, and as I said, I'm in mid-sentence.
I think they're going to face next week, too.
Right, you know, does that suit you then? I mean, it makes some sense, we...
Meeting too.
Yeah, okay. How about eight?
Eight.
Yeah, it's like, boy, I get to wield that to another attorney, just like a judge. Okay. Maybe just again, you can make sure you identify clearly for the record.
For the record, my name is Rich Cerkey. I'm an attorney in Plymouth, and I represent a number of citizens who are interested in this particular petition. The main point I want to leave you with, between now and when we come back, is that ask yourself whether AT&T has satisfied you that there are no alternative solutions available to address the so-called significant gap. I want to urge you to think about the site that's on the easel to my right, which is the site on Nile Terrace, which is off of Woodland Road. The Nile Terrace site, which is outlined in blue, is 15 acres in size, and the area that's surrounded by it in yellow on both sides of the railroad line is all vacant. So we're not talking about asking that the tower be relocated into another equally densely populated neighborhood. But we're asking that you consider this site because it's less densely populated and because it's town-owned. As a result of which, as we've heard over and over again, the lease payments will go to the town instead of to a private party. And I don't have to take up any of your time or my remaining 7 minutes telling you what your problem fiscal needs are and what you could do with that stream of income if it came to the town rather than to a private site. This site was one of the five municipal sites, as you've heard, that was listed in the September 29, 2009 initial letter from AT&T. And their April 18, 2013 letter indicates nothing has changed with respect to AT&T's coverage since the time of its first submission. And they repeated that at the May 26th opening session of this hearing. Now, not only would the stream of income come to the town rather than to a private party, but the Telecommunications Act has a built-in preference for public sites rather than private sites. Section 704 of the Telecommunications Act authorized procedures pursuant to which requests for the use of public property by providers ought to have the benefit of a presumption that they should be granted absent unavoidable direct conflict with the property custodian's mission or the current or planned use of the property. Technical support is provided to states to encourage them to make property under their jurisdiction available for such purposes. Now, in addition to the Nile Terrace site being 15 acres in size and owned by the town and surrounded by a huge amount of vacant land and adjacent to an operating railroad line, it would not require in all likelihood a setback variance the way the Tilted Road site requires, because the base of the tower is only 80 feet from the property line. Now, a petition has been prepared
and it will be filed at the town clerk's office tomorrow to insert in the warrant, and it has nearly 200 signatures, only 100 are required. The petition will ask the selectmen to insert in the warrant for the next special town meeting, which I understand will occur in September or October or November, an article that would authorize the selectmen to sell or lease all or a portion of this lot for the purpose of constructing and maintaining a wireless communication facility. That article will be on the warrant for the next special town meeting, which will occur, as I said, in September, October, or November. And so this, the town meeting will have the option of authorizing the selectmen to enter into a lease here. And so I say, if you put it here, the town is the winner, and not only financially, but it's in keeping with the Telecommunications Act, and fewer neighbors are impacted by it. So I yield back the balance of my time.
You did very well. Ivan, since we don't want to let you go, can you just again go back to and kind of discuss, you looked at that, and can you compare again for us the proposed site at Tilden Road with which is figure 13 on your and figure 8? What's the significant differences between the two in terms of coverage?
The big difference that you see is coverage to the north, in building coverage to the north, and then along the coast, there's actually some gaps of coverage from Mount Terrace versus Tilden Road. You see the areas of white are a little bit larger, and there's a little bit less green, of course, so as you go north, there's less in building coverage.
Any questions for Ivan relative to the Niles Terrace site?
We have one question, John, 331 Tilden. On the AT&T coverage maps, the Niles Terrace looked better on Anvinal, Countryway, and Turner Road, and a little worse on Oceanside. And so it was by sight of the map, it wasn't, it was no noticeable difference.
Gentleman behind you has a question.
Yes, Arnie Sharp, I hear you say not ideal or slightly less in building coverage. How does that compare to a significant gap of coverage in those areas?
Can you respond?
Sure.
Besides, in addition to the areas that Ivan mentioned, if you look at Exhibit 12, the last report or the first report. So I know it's in the last report we submitted in May, our April 18th, rather, 2013. If you look at Exhibit 12, you can see not only is there not in vehicle coverage on Countryway or in building, there's white gaps on Countryway that aren't covered. And then you have the additional population that is not covered by Oceanside Drive and Turner Road near the coast. So it is significant, and I mean, I'd be happy to go back and do the pop count.
Yeah, that'd be a good idea.
Plus, this, you have to also remember that this center line here that we ran at Nile Terrace was at 180-foot tower rather than 150-foot. Run at 177 feet. So we certainly considered it, but it didn't meet the coverage requirement, so we denied, we turned it down.
Again, let's, if we can, I'm really kind of trying to make sure that questions for not Ivan get answered.
It's more information management question.
Okay. All right, then, sir.
Richard Dillon, 364 Tilden. seems to be no perfect solution here. The Niles Terrace solution gets us, would you say it might get us 90% of what Dublin Road solution would give us? And just alleviate, you know, make significant progress and alleviate a lot of issues? Is it reasonable to think that it's a, there's only a 10% difference? Is it a 50% difference? What was your opinion?
Can you answer that?
I can't answer an exact percentage. It's,
well, then, you know, just
it's
best judgment.
I hate to throw numbers out.
I mean, if you're not comfortable with it, if you're not comfortable with it.
It's not like it's noticeable less. Like it's, you look at it and you go, oh my God.
But is that something that could be quantified and provided as information?
I think you should ask the applicant, okay. Yes. And one thing you may also want to ask the applicant is, if the percentage of POC that is less, okay, with the Nile Terrace site 177, then at what height would you have to go to equate that, to get those POCs back? So that the town understands that if it's 250 feet, if it's, you know, whatever it is, that's what you're dealing with.
Right. Unless 90%
of the POCs will be at the next meeting, the information.
And when we do this, it's important to know we're doing incremental POCs, meaning we're not taking any of the POCs that were covered by the existing sites. Right. Take the strongest server with the new site. It's not black and white. Now that you've got a new site there, they're going to cover people that were covered weakly or poorly by the existing site. So now it is the strongest server. So when we run the numbers, we only take incremental POPs. So I can tell you how many POPs are at 177 feet and how many are at, because if you go over 199 feet, you have to leave the tower.
But that's, I think that's important for the board to understand.
Right.
You know, and you just, yeah, it may be in the middle of that, but there's, I'm looking and there's still neighbors that are going to likely see that.
It's 150 houses on that map, at least.
Right, so it's just new neighbors.
Yeah. All right.
You want to look at it?
Yes.
John Chenich at 1597 Tilden Road. I'm curious as to why there were 5 acceptable sites, and now there's only 1 acceptable site that was not among the 5.
Okay. You know what? With that, I'm going to let you answer that next week. That's the cliffhanger, okay? Because that's really not for Ivan. And I want to thank everybody for their really thoughtful questions.
Tell them when the next meeting is.
Yeah, the next meeting. All right.
Move to continue the meeting until Tuesday, August
13th.
Tuesday, August 13th.
7
o'clock.
Second.
At the library.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. That's fine.